So what are some of the challenges facing the development of gene therapy for Duchenne and Becker muscular dystrophies? One of the first challenges is if you want to bring a new gene into muscles, how do you do that? How do you find a way to actually deliver a new gene to all of the muscles in the body? This has been, we think this may have been solved by the development of vectors or delivery vehicles that have been produced by manipulating naturally occurring viruses. And the idea there is that you want to remove from the virus its own genes, the genes that cause illness or disease, and replace them with your gene of interest. In this case, that would be a version of the dystrophin gene. The next question is, can you actually deliver dystrophin with these delivery vehicles? How can you fit a new dystrophin gene into a very small virus? And the problem there, the challenge, is that the dystrophin gene itself is the largest known gene. It's an enormous gene. It's about 100 times bigger than a typical gene in the human body. And it doesn't fit into the delivery vehicles. So we've approached that challenge by doing a number of studies over many years to try to produce smaller synthetic versions of the dystrophin gene that would still be effective in doing the role that the normal dystrophin gene does and hopefully correcting the disorder. And this has really been a long-term project. We've been working on this in my lab and in many other labs doing similar work for more than 25 years now. But I'm happy to say I think we're getting there, we're almost there, and clinical trials are beginning with this technology. There are alternate approaches, of course, that are being developed in the future, and a critical one is whether the mutant gene or the defective gene can actually be repaired rather than bringing in an artificial version of the gene. That's refers to the gene editing technology that, again, I'm going to go into at the end of the session. So the approach that has come into being over the last decade or two is to develop what we call systemic delivery systems, in other words, body-wide, whole-body delivery systems, using a delivery vehicle known as AAV vectors. What we're able to do now, we think, is achieve body-wide dystrophin replacement using these AAV and so-called micro-dystrophin vectors to deliver body-wide a new version of the dystrophin gene. This is a technique, this idea of using AAV vectors for systemic gene delivery was originally published by our laboratory more than 10 years ago. We showed that smaller dystrophins could be delivered body-wide using certain types of these AAV vectors. A limitation is that the dystrophin gene has to be shrunk down so much to fit into this delivery vehicle that it's no longer 100% functional, but it works really well, but it's not perfect, and I think that's an important point to emphasize. These genes, over the years, we've worked on many versions of dystrophin with different names. We had the so-called original full-length dystrophin, and then we made miniaturized dystrophins or mini dystrophins. The new ones we're working with are so small that we just arbitrarily named them micro-dystrophins. An advantage of this approach is that we think that this system doesn't depend on the type of mutation that a patient has, and hopefully this is a technology that would work with a single vector for all patients with Duchenne or Becker muscular dystrophy. Now, emerging strategies are, again, the gene editing approach, which was published by a couple of really exciting papers earlier this year in Science, the Science Journal. An advantage of this approach is that it potentially can make larger versions of dystrophin that might be more functional, but that, of course, depends on what the mutation a particular patient has. A slight disadvantage is that it's not a one-shot-fits-all approach. Different vectors would have to be made for different mutations. This is an emerging technology because the efficiency is still kind of low and there's some safety concerns, but those are solvable problems, and hopefully this is an approach that might be a little more permanent than a micro-dystrophin therapy. So the key to delivering new genes so far, a lot of different approaches have been tested. The one that has really risen to the top and is showing the best results is to use a delivery vehicle made from a natural virus known as adeno-associated virus, or AAV. This delivery system is developed by removing all of the viral genes. And this is also, even the natural virus has never been associated with any human disease, so it appears to be a very safe and effective delivery system. There are hundreds of different types of these AAV vectors. Several of them, though, have been shown to have a very unique property of being able to home into the muscle. So they're introduced right into the bloodstream, they leak out of the bloodstream, they go into muscle cells, and they drop off their cargo or their payload, which is a new synthetic version of the dystrophin gene. some of the limitations of AAV gene delivery systems are, again, the carrying capacity of this delivery vehicle is very small, and the dystrophin gene is very large, so there's a problem there. And so that led to the, or one of the things that took advantage of many years of work of trying to develop smaller and smaller versions of the dystrophin gene. Another slight disadvantage is that these AAV vectors don't work in stem cells, and stem cells are important for ongoing maintenance and repair of muscle cells, and so that leads to issues about what is the half-life of this system. Will it last in muscles for the lifespan of a patient? Probably not. We don't know what the half-life is. It's probably in the range of 10 to 15 years. So this is a method that may or may not need to be repeated every 10 or 15 years. So this is from some of our original work in trying to find vehicles that could deliver genes to muscle. This is work done by an outstanding postdoc that used to be in my lab, Paul Gregorovich. And he showed that using AAV vectors, if we kept injecting higher and higher doses, we achieved a level where at a certain dose, the vector started leaking out of the bloodstream. At lower doses, it all stays in the bloodstream or goes to the liver, but when you get up to high doses, it starts leaking out of the bloodstream and goes into muscle. And in this case, this experiment used not the dystrophin gene, but another gene that makes a dark purple color when it gets into muscle. And hopefully you can tell from an uninjected mouse, sorry, this is a bit of a gruesome photograph here, but this is sort of the upper part of a mouse. And this is the diaphragm muscle, the major muscle for breathing. This is the arm with all the arm muscles and some of the chest muscles here. When we deliver this AAV vector into the mice, all the muscles turn purple, indicating that the vector was able to transfer its payload to muscles body-wide. Now, the limitation, so at the time when it became clear that AAV vectors were useful for delivering genes to muscle, the problem remained that the dystrophin gene was too big. And fortunately, our lab and many other laboratories, including George Dixon, who's speaking here today, had spent a lot of time trying to understand the structure of the dystrophin gene, the structure of the dystrophin protein that was made by that gene, and it led to ideas on how to make smaller versions of it. This is a little cartoon here. Right here is what we've indicated as the dystrophin protein itself. It links to proteins inside of muscle cells. It assembles a large complex of additional proteins that bind to it that go outside of the muscle cell wall and line and interact with proteins in the outer connective tissue or the extracellular matrix. So dystrophin plays an important role in linking the inside to the outside of the muscle cells. And in doing so, it helps to preserve the structural integrity or keep intact muscle cells. When dystrophin is missing, these muscle cells become very fragile. So the key to developing smaller dystrophins was to retain the parts of dystrophin that were important for this linkage across the muscle cell membrane, but while shrinking down or removing parts that weren't that important. And to give you an indication, the normal dystrophin coating region to make the protein is almost 14,000 bases in length. This is just a unit of measuring the size of DNA. We were able to put together so-called micro-dystrophin genes that were about a third of that size, and that got us down to the level that that we could fit them into the AAV delivery system. This is just a cartoon, again, showing examples of how we did that. Again, this is a little representation of dystrophin protein. You don't need to worry about all these boxes. These represent individual parts of the dystrophin protein that each have their own unique function. And over many years, we did experiments to try to remove different parts of the dystrophin protein and ask what effect that had on how well that protein would still work. And a couple of things came out of that work. One, the very end of the protein was found that we could remove the entire end of the protein without having any impact on the function of that protein. However, a lot of the studies where we removed the beginning of the protein really affected the ability of that protein to work very well. So we kind of shied away from this part of the gene. The entire middle part of the gene was removed, but that completely inactivated the protein. But really a key breakthrough that started a lot of this work was an observation made by Kay Davies' lab back in the late 80s, where she identified a patient with a very large deletion that removed almost half of the dystrophin gene, and that's indicated right here. This is the protein that was made in that patient's muscles. And this individual was able to keep walking until, I believe, at least 75 years of age. So that's a remarkable protein. And again, it wasn't perfect. We found some ways to try to refine the removal of central parts of the dystrophin gene, and we came up with some fairly large deletions that could remove most of the center part of the protein without significantly affecting its function. We then removed the end of the protein, and by combining these different modifications, we made these miniature proteins that we refer to as micro-dystrophins. And here's an example. When we put these micro-dystrophin genes into these AAV delivery vehicles, injected them right into the bloodstream of mice, and followed those mice over time, we found that we achieved a very remarkable level of gene delivery to the muscles with a very profound impact on the dystrophic process. So here's an example of, this is normal muscle. This is a muscle from a dystrophic mouse model of the disease, and this is a dystrophic mouse treated with these AAV vectors. And what's shown in green here is the dystrophin protein. So normally you see the dystrophin protein in all the muscles of the body in these ring-type patterns lining the inside of all of the individual muscle cells. In dystrophic muscle, you very rarely see dystrophin-positive muscle cells, but in our treated animals, every muscle in the body was making essentially normal levels of this micro-dystrophin. And this is just an example. This is a low-power image of one of the muscles from the leg of a mouse, fully 1 year after a single infusion of this vector. So again, this appeared to be a very efficient gene delivery system. It was able to deliver these micro-dystrophins, and through a lot of different studies over many years, we've shown that those micro-dystrophins are very functional at halting the dystrophic process, restoring some of the strength, but they don't completely reverse the disease, but they're very highly effective. Here's an example. I won't go into the details of this, but if we just look at the strength of, in this case, we're looking at the diaphragm muscle and the major breathing muscles. This is the strength measurement in a normal mouse, a dystrophic mouse, and a treated mouse. So we haven't brought the strength completely back to normal, but it's much, much better than in the dystrophic mouse. Another measurement is to measure the fragility or how damaged can muscles be by extensive exercise and stretching. And we can monitor that by stretching muscles and measuring how strong they are. And the black line is a normal mouse muscle. The blue line is a dystrophic mouse muscle. So with stretches, it loses strength very quickly. But with our micro-dystrophin-treated muscles, the ability to resist this damaging process is back to normal. But since the strength level wasn't at the back to normal, we started asking, well, there must be other ways to make these micro-dystrophins. There's a lot of different ways to come up with these combinations of removing different parts of the protein. And so we embarked on a long project to try to come up with better and better micro-dystrophins. And this is an example of that. Again, this is a cartoon of the full dystrophin protein with all these different parts in there. And we designed a lot of different versions of this that have different regions to bind to other proteins and things like that, and have been testing those out. And we came up with a couple that worked much better than the original ones. And again, this is a strength assay, again, just looking at the strength of the diaphragm muscle. This is what we see in normal muscle. This is what we see in the dystrophic muscle. And these are just some of the newer micro-dystrophins we've developed. One of them in particular that we refer to as micro-dystrophin 5, it's just an arbitrary lab name, is able to get back almost to the ability to restore normal strength to these dystrophic muscles. Here's another assay we've been working on, which is just ask how active or how mobile are these dystrophic mice. One of the things that was observed by Kevin Campbell's lab a number of years ago is if you take a dystrophic mouse and have it exercise a little bit, they tire very easily and they tend to sit in their cage and not move around. So we measured the mobility of these mice before and after exercise, and as you can see, after a very limited, about a 10-minute bout of exercise, they tend to not want to move around very much. Very significant decrease in mobility, but the micro-dystrophin 5 treated muscles, these mice are as active, if not a little more active than the normal mice, and even after exercise, they retain their normal levels of, or close to normal levels of activity, so that's a very encouraging sign as well. The other thing is that One of the limitations of working with a mouse model is that mice only live to be about 2 years of age. So we asked the question, if we infuse these micro-dystrophin genes into mice soon after they were born, how long would this delivery system last for? And here's an experiment where we treated mice at about 2 weeks of age, followed them out for 2 years, close to their normal lifespan, and I don't know if the slide is not showing up very well, but basically, looking again at the diaphragm muscle, which is a very severely affected muscle in the mouse model, we see widespread dystrophin expression throughout the diaphragm muscle and other muscles of the mouse. Probably can't see this very well. This is just different stains to look at the structure or the overall appearance of the muscle, and the diaphragm muscle, even 2 years after treatment, looks completely normal. We started advancing this into larger animal models, and these are some studies we did in Seattle looking at the dog model for Duchenne muscular dystrophy. In this case, we were only looking at a single muscle, infusing the vector into that muscle. And this is a treated animal, again, 2 years after the single treatment. We see widespread dystrophin throughout the injected muscle. It restores expression of the proteins that all bind to or interact with dystrophin. In an untreated animal, you see a very kind of dystrophic appearance of the muscle compared to the treated muscles. Normally, you don't see any dystrophin. So the method doesn't just work in mice. It works pretty well in dystrophic dogs. And this approach has been scaled up considerably by groups working with Solid GT that have licensed this technology from us. So in summary, AAV methods of delivering microdystrophin, the current versions of microdystrophin are able to completely stop ongoing muscle wasting and turnover, they prevent exercise-induced injuries, and they increase the strength of the muscles. We haven't detected any loss of the microdystrophin production in these muscles for at least 2 years, which is about as long as we can go out in these animal models. As I mentioned, that very efficient whole body delivery of these vectors has been achieved in dogs by groups working with Solid GT, and particularly Dongcheng Duan's lab at the University of Missouri and Joe Carnegie at Texas A&M. The other encouraging thing in terms of moving this into clinical trials, which hopefully will happen soon, is that looking at some other diseases, in particular very recently with spinal muscular atrophy, a different neuromuscular disorder by Brian Pasfar's lab at Ohio State, has shown that very high doses of these AAV vectors can be delivered to patients with this disease without any side effects. So that's very encouraging and helps pave the way for trials of Duchenne patients, which we know are being developed currently by Solid GT and hopefully will commence in the next year or so. So just very briefly, I'm just going to talk a little bit about next generation technologies. We've probably all heard a lot in the popular press about a so-called gene editing technology, which is designed to try to repair a gene rather than replace that gene. And so we've been working on this in our laboratory using AAV vectors to deliver the so-called CRISPR-Cas9 components, which are the molecules that are necessary for gene repair. And this is an example of a systemic infusion of an AAV vector that's making this CRISPR-Cas9 system into the mouse model of Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Hopefully what you can see here is a low-power image of the heart. The green here reflects new dystrophin production in various limb muscles in the diaphragm. You also can see somewhat lower levels of dystrophin production. So the method does work. We're able to correct the dystrophin gene, produce new dystrophin protein, but as you can probably tell, the efficiency is somewhat low. Here's a side-by-side comparison we did to compare sort of the current generation of microdystrophin delivery with this CRISPR-Cas9 gene repair technology. This is a normal mouse, a dystrophic mouse. But with microdystrophin delivery, we get widespread high-level production of this microdystrophin. With the gene editing approach, we get widespread expression of dystrophin, but the levels and the overall distribution are significantly lower. So this is a promising technology, but it's work in progress and needs significant improvement to work. So I'm going to stop there, and are we going to save questions for the end?